Thank you.
The format that we're going to follow this morning, this afternoon, I'll get it right eventually, this afternoon, is I'm going to start by asking Howard a few questions. By the way, I'm not being overly personal. I've been told that Mr. Buffett greatly prefers Howard as the term to address him with. I hope that's accurate.
It's better than what most of the staff call me. So I mean, it's like.
So I will ask a few questions to set the stage. We'll then open it up for questions from the audience. And I'd like to begin with a discussion about the reality that this war college educates already experienced leaders who will be facing a variety of challenges, some of them new, in this complex leadership environment once they leave this institution and go back to the real world. You, as CEO of a private family foundation that invests over $150 million a year in efforts to address global food security, including water security, and to mitigate conflict, have confronted a wide range of challenges. Perhaps you could tell us a bit about some of those leadership challenges that you've had to grapple with in your capacity as the CEO.
Well, the biggest leadership challenge is people. And that's on both ends. I mean, finding people that fit with the organization and your culture and the way you want to behave. And we're quite different as a foundation in a number of ways, and hopefully we'll get into some of that. So finding people who are comfortable with the way we approach things is not easy. We don't invest in organizations. We spend a lot of money, but we're not investing in organizations or other NGOs. We're investing in other people. So on the other side of the equation, it's also people. And so we look for people we can trust. We're looking for long-term partnerships and relationships. And so if you looked at our sheet of people that we give money to, I mean, it might look somewhat typical in terms of the number of people, but if you looked at where 80% of our money went, it went to probably four or five organizations, which we have continually done the majority of our funding over a long period of time. And that's because we have people that, not that we just trust, but we can disagree with, and they can disagree with us. And so I find it the most difficult part is people on both ends of it. I think that it takes a long time to build trust. And so I go into a relationship thinking long term, but realizing that it may be short term. And I find it valuable to go into it thinking long term, just because then when there are mistakes made and people let you down, you don't immediately give up. And the biggest thing I think that I try to remember in my mind is my dad always told me, remember your circle of competence. And that doesn't mean it's a tricky thing, because you stay in your circle of competence in terms of what your innate ability and skills are at the time of whatever you're dealing with. But you never want to stay comfortable staying in your circle of competence in terms of what you try and what you're willing to risk. So you have to know where your limits are in terms of being able to analyze things correctly, being able to assess things correctly, and coming up with good ideas and good solutions. But you never want something to stop you from adventuring out and being more innovative and taking risk. And so I've done that. I mean, our foundation is, I mean, I do a lot of things on my gut feel. I do a lot of things without all the information, just like you would have to do in a battle. I mean, you don't know exactly how many troops the other guy has. You don't know exactly where they all are. You don't know exactly what weapons he has and his capabilities. But you have to be able to make decisions quickly, and you have to be comfortable with those decisions, so they're not all going to work out right. When they don't work out right, you move on, you don't look back. So for me, I think a lot of it is the people that you can put around you, and then the people that you deal with, and selecting them very carefully.
Thank you. Conflict mitigation, one of the core elements of your mission. What role does leadership from the private or public sector need to play in addressing some of the issues of conduct? Perhaps you can give us some examples of where your organization has been involved in conflict mitigation.
Well, I can give you a couple examples that involve both the military and private individuals, I think. I had a great experience. I went to Afghanistan kind of by accident, because my sister had a conversation with General Petraeus and volunteered me to go, and actually it's great, but so I went, and you know, at that time there was a task force that had been established. It's pretty well dismantled now. I don't know the exact status of it, but it made me realize that to make good decisions in conflict areas, you can't do it by public opinion. And today, that's a big problem, and it's a big problem for our military. When you're dealing with a warlord up in the mountains, and you're trying to establish a relationship, he doesn't have a checking account or an ATM or anything else. So, you know, if you're going to drive a Toyota Land Cruiser up there with $100,000 in cash and make a deal with him in terms of building schools or health clinics or whatever it is, you know, that lends yourself on one side to a lot of questions about accountability and transparency. But it also lends you to needing to get the public to understand that there is no other way to do it, and you're fighting a different war. And if you want to win that war, you have to do it in an unconventional way. So I think that, you know, I came away from Afghanistan with a couple lessons. First of all, I think General McChrystal, I know neither one of them were Navy guys, but General McChrystal and General Petraeus are two of the greatest heroes of this country. I mean, they could think right, they could act right, they both make, you know, personal mistakes, but I don't believe that a personal mistake is you know, erases everything you've done for a country over many years. And I got the privilege of watching McChrystal operate in a way where he brought in civilians, he brought in other countries, and he developed a very different thinking about how to approach this war. That's not easy to do. And I also watched Petraeus do it. And these guys were very personal guys, very involved and engaged personally, and cared about it. And I think, you know, so in Afghanistan, I got to spend time with this task force on several trips and watch how they operated. And then I watched the politics dismantle it. When, you know, politics and war don't go together. because you have to be able to make these decisions independently in the field and not be second-guessed, you know, 5,000-10,000 miles away. And that's a big challenge. In Central African Republic, we work in parallel with DOD. One of the four different commanders we've worked with there was a Navy SEAL. And I think one of the biggest mistakes made in that strategy was that every 6 months they would rotate the commander out. Very hard to establish. I mean, one of the key things was establishing relationships with the Ugandan military, and very hard to do that if every 6 months you start over. Very hard. And, you know, a couple of them were, they were all good, but a couple of them were exceptional, and a couple of them were not as good. And, you know, this is just the beginning of me getting in trouble. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, we have to learn how to adapt to the environment where we are. And if we didn't learn that back in Vietnam, I mean, we just have not learned that lesson. And so we go in, and when you fly into this base, you know, you basically see the Taj Mahal, which are, you know, about 100 containers stacked up, tents, swimming pool, all this stuff for the U.S. base. And next to it, you know, 500 yards away, are these Ugandans living in these tents, little straw huts, on the dirt floor. And how are we going to relate to these guys when we come in and try to bring America to the middle of South Sudan or Central African Republic? It doesn't work. When we were last there a few months ago, one of the Ugandan, the colonel, we call him Colonel Mike, who was in charge of the operation, he was ecstatic. He says, oh, they left these generators and these big tents and air conditioning, all that stuff. So they were using all of it. But it, it, it's, those guys, I mean, the Ugandans have to be sitting there looking at us thinking, what are we doing? Okay. Now, the flip side of that is we gave them tremendous support, and they know that. I mean, we the flip side of it is we did what we do really well and what our military does really well. And they could not catch anybody of significance. And the first thing that, and this is one of probably 100 examples, but the first thing our guys did is said, look, you're going after the largest group when they split up, when you get in a firefight. You want to go after the smallest group because they're going to have the most important guy because they're moving the quickest. Bingo. Within a month, they catch the general, you know, the second guy in command of the Lord's Resistance Army. They brought a level of sophistication in terms of intelligence gathering and intelligence analysis that was far beyond the Ugandans' capability. So, you know, we helped change the game on the ground for this particular set of circumstances. And I don't doubt for a minute we can do that anywhere in the world. But we need to learn how to adapt to the context and the environment in which we are working, I think, much better in that scenario. I think in a lot of ways we did that in Afghanistan from the lessons that we learned in Iraq. But, you know, conflict is difficult, and you're never going to get it right. And the most important thing, I mean, I believe in taking risk, and that means that those officers have to have the ability to make those decisions and make those decisions freely so that they are not reprimanded later or have an issue later because they made those decisions. So I think we have an incredible amount to offer the world in terms of helping in conflict areas through our military, but I think we could improve.
Your organization has worked through the U.S. military. Many non-governmental organizations are reluctant, to say the least, to do so. Do you see your foundation engaging more with the U.S. military, or are the risks associated with that simply too high?
Well, now I'm going to really get in trouble. So we had a great dialogue going through the Pentagon a couple years ago, 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, at the highest levels. And we met with several two-star generals as follow-up, and we had other meetings, and we had a list of projects, 9 projects that DOD felt would be very beneficial to them in the field. About 3 or 4 of them completely aligned with what we were doing either in Congo or other areas in Africa. And then it went just totally cold, and we don't know why it went cold. But I think it's an example of maybe an attorney getting involved, maybe politics getting involved. I don't know what it was. But what I do know is that, and I'll answer your other part of the question in a minute, but what I do know is that we were very willing to work in additional areas with the military. They have to learn how to work with us. They have to learn how to work with private, whether it's foundations or individuals or companies. The second part of your question, they do work. I mean, there's a group called Spirit of America, which they work with very well. But when you hear the story, when Jim tells you the story, what they've gone through to get there, you know, it's a nightmare. And it shouldn't be a nightmare, okay? It should be something where our government can partner with people who want to partner with them and do things that the government cannot do, which is exactly what we did in Central Africa Republic. They needed canine teams. We brought in 10 dogs and trainers. They needed a helicopter. They had 2 helicopters. I can't remember what kind because I wasn't familiar with what they were, but they were stationed like 250 miles away. By the time they could ever get their response time was way beyond what it needed to be. We had a Bell 412 up there that we paid for a little over 2 years. Now, we have limitations on what we can do. We could not have that helicopter and be funding it for military operations, but we could have it bringing out, we could use it for humanitarian purposes, which meant if there were defecting soldiers, we could bring them out. It meant if there were people who had been captured by the LRA and they escaped, we could bring them out. It meant we could provide medical relief. So there were critical components of what we could do, and there are obviously other things we couldn't do. But we could fill in a bit of a hole that existed. The canine teams were just something that, from a money standpoint, from a probably money being the biggest one, but from a you know, just a logistical standpoint, they weren't going to get them there. It wasn't going to happen. They've been a game changer on the ground, just a game changer. And that was easy for us to do. We knew right where to go, you know, for the dogs. We knew how to do it. We knew where to get the trainers. You could have given us a list of 10 more things like that in that situation that we could do that the military couldn't do, and we probably would have done them. So that's a very frustrating thing for us. To answer the key part of your question about why we've done it, do we worry about the risk, why do others not do it? There's absolutely a risk with associating yourself with the U.S. government anywhere. There's absolutely a risk with associating yourself even further with anything that's related to the military. I believe you pick those scenarios very carefully. You know, we would not do that in a lot of places, but we would absolutely do it in places where we realize that the risk is lower because the need is great and no one else is going to meet the need. So in Central African Republic, going after the Lord's Resistance Army, supporting a bigger operation there in a small way, which we had the opportunity to work with another private individual who brought that to us. I mean, we didn't, and that's how we got involved. But, you know, to me, there's little risk in that. I mean, you look at what the mission is, you look at what the end goal is, and if somebody didn't like it because the military is involved, screw it. I mean, you know, that's not my problem. I mean, you know, that's their problem, because it takes certain assets, it takes certain training, certain discipline, and if you don't have those things, well, you won't have those things in a lot of cases unless you have a military involved, and sometimes that's what it takes to do it. So I think, you know, we would select it carefully, you know, where we did it and why we did it, but I have, and there's still a risk with that, but I have no issue with someone criticizing me because we partnered with the U.S. military. What they're doing, in the cases where we partnered in Afghanistan and in Central Africa, both of those were driven very strongly by humanitarian purposes and humanitarian goals, things that we could not accomplish without a partner like the U.S. military. I felt privileged to work alongside some of the people that we worked with who are very committed to making change in those areas. And we just couldn't have done it without those kinds of assets and intelligence and training.
Thank you. Well, I have lots more questions to ask, but I suspect the audience does as well. Before I open it to questions, and because I'm getting really old and may forget otherwise, the foundation has provided the Howard G. Buffett Foundation has provided copies of his book, 40 Chances, as well as a book that is not available publicly for sale. That's photographs that have been taken by Howard in his travels. Each of you are allowed to take one of those books each. We have checked with the JAG. It is perfectly legal. You are allowed to take one each. So
that's what he tells you now.
Got it in writing. We're good to go. So please, who wants to begin?
Well, first, I have to say, there's a photography book that accompanies it because the publisher wouldn't let me publish color photographs. And when you do that to a photographer, I mean, that's like telling a sniper he can't fire his weapon or something. So anyway,
I should have mentioned one of the other interest areas is photography that Howard has. I'm going to start with Greg.
Thank you, Professor Kelly. Hi, Howard. Greg Groth. I'm a State Department Foreign Service Officer studying national security here for a year. I just came from 3 years with David Lane.
Oh, wow, yeah. Good friend.
UN Food and Agriculture Organizations in Rome. Thank you, first of all, for you and your foundation's work around the world in global food and water security. I'd be interested to hear whether you feel that global water and food insecurity poses a threat to U.S. national security, and if so, what can we, the United States, the U.S. government, and the U.S. military do about that threat?
Well, it absolutely causes a threat to us. And I think that the more people you have that are disgruntled, dissatisfied, hungry, and in a conflict or post-conflict area, and all of those pieces either combined or individually, they will add to unrest. And if we haven't seen that in the last 2 or 3 years, then, you know, we're not paying attention. And so, you know, the area I'm most familiar with these days is Eastern Congo. And I look at that and I see an unbelievably bungled attempt by the United Nations. I'm talking about a specific instance because I've seen the UN do a lot of great things. But, you know, I've seen it. You talk about leadership. You have a president of in DRC who has basically given the UN a proxy to rule in Eastern Congo because he can't control it. And that creates then the conflicts with neighboring countries and everything else. But the point being that what that allows is there's a lot of hungry people because they're food insecure. They don't have access to water in many cases. In fact, I can tell you a great story, if I remember to at the end of this, about a water story. So I think when you look at what the UN did in terms of going in and dismantling the M23 militarily, I personally think it was a big mistake not to sign a real peace agreement with them. And the violence in that area is much worse than it was. And we have this, as you know from the State Department, we make two mistakes. We try to pick the good guys and the bad guys. In that environment, most everybody's a bad guy, so you're trying to judge who's not as bad. And that's not easy to do. And you're going to make mistakes on that. And the other thing we do is we set up, you know, okay, the M23's gone, now the problem's gone. That was a symptom. That's not the problem. And so you have the FDLR, the ADF, and all these people working there. So kind of to your point, not exactly focus on the food security and water security, but the ADF is apparently becoming stronger. The FDLR is becoming stronger. They continue to attack across the Rwandan border. There's a lot of these things the State Department would know about that we don't read about in the newspaper. The long and short of that is, think about an Eastern Africa that has a strong radical Islamic country under its control. That is closer than we would like to think. It can come down from Somalia across into Kenya. It can come across from Congo into Uganda. As long as Kagame's in Rwanda, it won't happen in Rwanda, but that could change in the next 10 years, who knows. You have strong Islamic-based militants that are operating freely in areas around those countries. And if you don't think that's not a threat, you know, when you lose that, it is 10,000 times more difficult to get it back. Probably that's an underestimate. But we need to decide in this country, and there's very, very different opinions about this. And I'm very influenced and biased because of what I've seen in Africa. But we need to decide, and we need the leadership of this country to decide, are we going to play a major role now in trying to prevent some of the activity that can take place, or are we going to resolve ourselves to putting ourselves in a no-win situation like we've done, and I say Vietnam because I was in high school getting ready, I graduated in 73 when they signed the armistice in February of 73, not knowing what would happen. We've watched it in Vietnam, we watched it in Iraq, we watched it in Afghanistan, and Iraq's playing out now. I mean, you know, and Afghanistan will play out. And so we have to decide, are we going to go in for the long term and seriously commit resources and take the time to understand the culture, the context, and what those countries need, not just what we want, but what those countries need, and make a 30-year commitment. If you make anything less than a 30-year commitment, you're going to end up in the same situation we've ended up in all these other examples that I've given, and there's other ones that you could give. So I think it's a significant threat. What will happen is people will become, wherever it is, you know, if they're hungry or they can't get water, they're pretty easily recruited into a conflict situation. And I remember going through the Kono diamond mines in Sierra Leone a few years after the conflict ended, and there were thousands, miles long, because we flew over in a helicopter, thousands of these 18, 19, 20, 21-year-old guys, you know, mining for hope, just looking for one diamond. And I'm thinking, that is a ready-made military. You tell them you're going to feed them. You tell them you're going to pay them a little bit. And I hate to say it this way, but in many parts of the world, you tell them they're going to have access to a woman, and you give them a gun, and I will tell you what, you've got a military. Now, they're not well-trained, and they're not disciplined at all, but they still take orders. And that's the worst kind, because then you have, and we've seen this in Eastern Congo, you have every military faction you can discuss that comes in under the auspices of what's going on in Eastern Congo, and they've all raped individuals, they've all done terrible things, and they are supposed to be the most disciplined people, and they're supposed to be the people that you depend on. They're supposed to end the conflict, not contribute to it. So it's actually quite depressing, because it's very hard to see how you get from where we are to where we need to be. But if you take water and food, those are big, big drivers. And we've seen it, whether it's, you know, Egypt or Syria. I mean, people in Syria, 60 Minutes just did a great, great story on this. People in Syria are not dying from the conflict. They are dying from hunger. Thousands of them are dying from hunger. And so, you know, if you combine, and I don't think you can separate these things, you combine the people that hate this country, and most of it's religious, under a religious guise, and some of it's philosophical, but if you take people who hate this country and hate democracy, those people become their best friend, and not by choice necessarily. And so it's a big deal. I'll tell you really quickly, if I can, just this water story. So this goes to a number of issues. It goes to leadership, because I'm going to tell you a guy that's a phenomenal leader. It goes to trust and partnership, and you'll see why when I explain the story. But when the M23 went in and took over Goma, when the FARDC retreated, they cut the power lines to the city, in a way, obviously, get the M23 blamed for it. But that's pretty irrelevant in terms of the outcome. But the power lines were cut. So you had a scenario that had been played out about 4 or 5 years earlier, where there were no pumping stations and no filtering stations for the lake, where everybody would come to get the water. And so people started taking the water directly out of the lake. And played out before, they literally had thousands of people a week, hundreds and some thousands and times, dying of cholera and related disease, as you would expect. So we get this email the day before Thanksgiving from Emmanuel, who runs, he's the head park, well, the game warden or whatever his title is, I can't remember exactly, for Virunga National Park in Eastern Congo. He's an amazing guy. Since my books are free, I can say this. There's a chapter about him in the book. But he sent me an email because he couldn't get through on the cell phone. And he said, we need to get 4 generators to get these filtering systems running at the lake. Now, if it had been anybody else, I would have laughed. I mean, it was a serious situation. But, I mean, I would have laughed. I'm thinking, 4 generators into Eastern Congo. Let's see. You're telling me you can do that in 24 to 48 hours, and I'm thinking, I wouldn't believe anybody could do that in 12 months. So because it was Emmanuel, I knew that if he said he could do it, he could do it. Huge amount of trust on my side of it. We couldn't communicate by phone. Thanksgiving came. We got another email. I asked Tricia on Thanksgiving, I said, are the banks open tomorrow? And she said, yes. I said, okay. What I got out of the email is he needs $187,000, but send him $200,000 because he's going to need it for something. So we sent him the money without him knowing we sent him the money. He believed we would send him the money, so he had already started to get the generators. So when he found out we had the money, he said, well, I'm going to have the generators in 12 hours, because I was not in an arrogant way, but I was hoping and assuming and praying that you would send the money. And within about, what was it, Ann, within 48 hours?
Within 24 hours, he had 3.
Yeah, within 24 hours, he had 3 generators hooked up, and people had filtered water in that city, and he got power back in the hospitals. So that was the best $200,000 I've ever spent in my life, I can tell you that. You cannot go backwards and say, okay, how many lives did we save? How many people did we save? But based on history, it was thousands. So that was leadership. That was related to water security. It was trust. It was partnership. Those are the key things. This country, to be able to implement a similar type of philosophy, needs to look at our foreign relationships differently. It needs to look at long-term allies. We can't hold them to be perfectly in the mirror image that we want to see them in, and we have to go into it understanding that they are not going to do everything we want them to do the way we want them to do it. It's a tough PR sell. I think the biggest challenge today is that, you know, anything that happens, everybody knows about it in a minute or 5 minutes. And so everybody's got an opinion. Everybody can express that opinion with zero accountability. Okay? You can make statements on the internet, or I don't do Twitter and all that stuff because my wife calls me low tech and high maintenance, and she's right. But, you know, you can spew anything out there you want to. And now you're in a defensive mode. And on top of it, it could be absolutely not true. And there's no accountability. So I think we live in a world today, combined with your question about water security and food security, and with the kind of groups we have that target this country and our own philosophies, and you combine that with social media, I mean, that is something we have never dealt with before.
New challenges. Did I see you?
Yes. Yeah. Hi, I'm Greg Kelly. I'm also with the Department of State, but Greg took my questions, so I've tweaked it just a little bit. I served in the Gambia on my very first assignment, and we did a lot of projects with the embassy with small groups, women's groups, farming projects, and that beehives, those kind of things. One of the things we found in just observations and in talking to people was that the food shortages or the water issues were not because you couldn't grow things there. They were because of gross mismanagement of the government. I don't know what you see as these transnational issues can bring us into conflict. What's the underlying issue under a lot of these shortages? I mean, people throw out climate change, they throw out bad governance. What do you think is the one issue that we need to address to try and alleviate some of these problems?
Well, I have to give you two.
Okay.
Because they go together in the long run. We can spend all the money we want to spend. The Gates Foundation, the U.S. government, USAID. I mean, we can all spend all the money we want to spend in Africa. Until there are two things that change, it'll never have a significant impact at scale. You have to have rule of law, and you have to have property rights. And the property rights really come back to the more to the question that you're asking. Well, I mean, they both do, but I can tell you that every successful society in terms of agriculture has both rule of law and property rights. And property rights are critical. And property rights are not just saying, okay, you have a title. I can use that. I can trade that. I can sell that. I can protect it in a court of law. I can use it as an asset to buy another piece of land or improve my land or whatever it is. Until you have those two things, I don't see how you change anything to where you can walk away from a country and feel really good that this is a self-sufficient country doing what it should do and what it wants to do, and that when I say what it should do, I mean that the citizens are free and they're well-fed and they have access to what they need. So I don't think you can do it without those two things. Now, it's easier for us to say that because from the standpoint of what we do as a foundation, because if you look at where we are and what we're doing things pretty much that no other foundation will do, pretty much where they won't do it. So in that scenario, I say we are trying to take an identified geographic area and have a significant impact on it. And we are doing stuff the government should be doing. And that's a problem long term. That is a big problem. I mean, when we're building the largest infrastructure project in Eastern Congo, a $20 million hydroelectric plant, and we're building roads, and we're building water systems, that is not the solution. We're doing it, but it's not the solution. Because The government has to do certain things, and that's something. Those are things they should be doing. We're doing it. We did it for a couple of reasons. One is we started that engagement because we wanted to do something before the conflict ended, because we wanted to have an opportunity for the Congolese government to make a different decision than what they've made historically, which was to allow people to come back and integrate into their communities and have jobs available. We could guarantee if the M23 put their weapons down, we could guarantee if the FDLR put their weapons down, those who did not commit crimes, who had to pay for crimes at a certain level, because you're always going to deal with that. But we could guarantee that those people could go to work at least for a year and make a decent wage. We could guarantee that with the projects that we have in place today. There are too many people that don't want that to happen. There are people with other agendas that don't want that to happen. There are the hardest thing. I mean, I got to tell you, there's a couple agencies in the UN that I think do amazing work. They do yeoman's work. They are amazing what they do. UNHCR and WFP. But when you have MINUSCO sitting there for over a decade with tens of millions of dollars distorting the economy, participating in activities that are not positive. This probably means I won't get into Congo next week, but that's where I'm going. That's a problem. When you have a government that's a sovereign government relying on an external force to control an area that hasn't had elections for years, that's a problem. So, you have to look at it from my perspective, and I have to look at it, and I have to say there is an absolute role for the United States to play in this, and a military role is a big part of it. Not going in guns blazing, going in and helping them understand the logistics and the intelligence and the successful, what it takes to use technology successfully to defeat some of these groups that keep this area destabilized. The UN is not going to do that. They got a very specific mission. They got a couple of countries say we'll show up, and they went and defeated one enemy. There's 100 enemies in eastern Congo in just that one province, okay? So we have to make our mind up. I said this earlier. I mean, we have to make our mind up. What role do we want to play, and how long are we going to commit to it? There is nothing that you can do on the international side of things that you can figure out. It's like farming. You can't say, that I'm going to figure this out in 2 or 3 years. I'm going to figure this out in 5 years. Everything, the landscape changes. In farming, the weather's different. Everything changes. So you have to be patient. And you have to, I'm going to say it again, you have to realize that everybody isn't going to do it your way. So we have to figure out, are we willing to do that? And if we're not willing to do that, you will see a lot more conflict around food security, a lot more conflict around water security. Not that we can solve all the problems, don't get me wrong, but we can help mitigate some of them, and particularly in the hot spots. So you have to have leadership that will go against public opinion, that isn't scared to lose their job, that thinks that what they are doing is the right thing to do. And, you guys would be very familiar with, and you'd probably laugh at it because you always have to put a bunch of drama into it, but, behind enemy lines. According to that story, that admiral lost his, command because he made a decision that he thought he had to make as a commander and as a human being. You have to allow people to do that. When you talk about leadership in the military, it's a little different because, and it's closer to law enforcement because you do it by rank, okay? So when the admiral shows up, you're gonna salute this man and you're gonna do what he tells you to do. And that's how a military works, okay? You cannot lose that. You have to have the discipline. But you also have to have an element of decision making where the people that you have put in those leadership positions can make decisions and they can make mistakes and not pay so heavily for the mistakes. And so, I see a huge opportunity for our military to play a role in mitigating some of the circumstances, and particularly in the places where we work. But that takes real work. I mean, that takes relationship building. That takes something that I think we have tried at times to replace with technology. And you can't replace people with technology. So, I mean, I love technology and I love what we can do with it, whether you're talking about the military or farming or whatever you're talking about. I mean, the technology is cool stuff and it's amazing stuff. But it comes down to people and giving them the ability to lead. And a lot of times we fall short on that.
Thank you.
Questions from others, please.
Sir Jason Cockham, U.S. Air Force.
Non-State Department.
Finally. No.
thank you for being here today and talking with us. That question in particular is very specific. It's water security. Have you, obviously, with nearly 20,000 acres under, I guess, cultivation production, as well as in your experience in Africa, what do you see specific to groundwater? Are you witnessing shrinking groundwater, and how do you feel that will become a factor in food security?
Well, there's no question it's shrinking, and it's shrinking globally. Okay, we have a problem here in the United States, and we're living that problem a little bit. One of the reasons why I bought this farm that we have in we have both a farm and a ranch in Arizona, and one of the reasons I bought the farm is it's in an area where farmers are going out of business because they're running out of water or they're running out of affordable water. We have drilled our sixth 1,300 foot well, putting a 400 horsepower motor on it, pumping from 700 feet. You can imagine what that takes. I mean, that's worth about 70 bushels of corn, okay? So an average farmer can't go do that. We can do it for other reasons, but it's not sustainable. So we have the same issue in South Africa. We use surface water there. That water, there are years now where we have some of our ground we rent because we haven't used it all. There are years where we can't rent it because we can't guarantee the water. Okay, so when I look at water in the United States, I think that it's like everything we do. It's classic 101 human behavior. We don't fix it until it's a problem. We don't deal with it until it affects us. And so we're going to continue to behave that way. And we will see it become a bigger and bigger issue. It will affect food security. Now, we will probably be, for a long time in this country, we'll be able to come up with other ways to work around that, because we'll have the money or we'll spend the money or we'll use technology or we'll do different things. There's a lot of places where food is grown. Saudi Arabia is a great example of this. If you go back in the 1970s, look at a satellite image, you'll see thousands and thousands of center pivot irrigation systems. Zero today. Okay, they decided they were going to be self-sufficient on wheat. That cost them so much money, they couldn't even afford it. Okay, and then you alkalize the soil. It isn't always as simple as people think. Okay, it doesn't just give it water. There's a lot of things that have to work with that. So, in the United States, I'm hoping that we get smart enough about it fast enough that we change some of our behavior. We have some solutions that we can put in place that help us, and so I'm not. I feel we can do that if we don't wait until it's too late. But it's a long ways before it's too late, but we are still losing a lot that we could have been preserving. The problems are much bigger, I think, globally. You look at the Nile River and you look at the countries that are affected by that and you look at the old agreements that exist, there's going to be war fought over that. Now, whether it's an official war or whether it's three countries fighting, you know, in the bush or whatever it is, there will be people killed over that. There will be people that do not get water, that die as a result. I mean, it's going to become more and more acute. It is becoming more and more acute. And so there is no, I mean, it's like all big problems. There's no easy answer to that, except the smartest thing you can do is recognize it and deal with it. But those are situations where other than people from the U.S. giving advice and maybe helping with some technology, but you can't solve this problem with technology completely. I mean, technology can help, but you know, those countries are going to have to solve those problems themselves. I mean, and how that works its way through, I have no idea. But it, I don't have an answer for it, but it is going to be a significant problem. And it will create more conflict globally. And you never know when it's going to come or where it's going to come from.
Thank you very much.
Before I ask for the next question, and I will get around to folks, we originally were scheduled to go to 1,300. Because we were a little bit late starting, Howard has agreed to stay on longer. I recognize that some of you may have other commitments. If you have to leave, just get up and leave. Stop by and help yourself to a book on the way out, okay? Hands back there. Charles, please.
Yes, Howard and Charles Kupoy, professor at the leadership. So we've been studying several leaders here, military, political, and also civilians. So from your perspective, can you give us some leadership advice in terms of what we should focus on?
Well, the one thing I learned from watching my dad was always put people around you that are smarter than you. And that is a leadership quality, because most people don't want to do that for their own self-interest. And so you have to be willing to take that risk. But I'll tell you, that risk will pay off 100-fold. So the first thing is be willing to get the right people around you, and don't be worried about if they are better at certain things than you are or smarter than you are in certain ways. That will make you do your, that will allow you to do your job better, and you will be a better leader. I think, you know, when I was at Archer Daniels Midland, one of the things, there's an old saying, but one of the things, I would walk in and ask Dwayne Andreas if I could do something, and he'd look at me and go, "I'll always give you enough rope to hang yourself." And he had that philosophy, and I believe in that philosophy, because I believe in let people be innovative. That is a leadership quality. Many people can't live with that, and many people don't know how to live with it, because if you give people enough, you know, rope to hang themselves, you don't want to hang them every time, okay? You want to give them an opportunity to understand what they learned from what they did and be better at the next decision. So, I mean, you clearly want to develop people around you that you want them to develop the confidence to make decisions. And when they make mistakes, there's a fine line between holding people accountable and hanging them. And so I think that's a second thing. I said this earlier, but I'm going to bring it back into this conversation or this answer, because know your circle of competence. If you're a leader, you need to know what you understand and what you don't. So when you're a president, I'm not saying this, I'm just saying in theory, if you're the president of the United States and you're going to go in, let's pick history, go into Iraq or go into Afghanistan, you better know how to get the right people around you, and you better get the right people around you, and then you better listen to them. Know your circle of competence. The competence of that president, any president, is never going to be how to strategically go in and successfully implement a program in a sort of, or whatever it is, in a place like Iraq. There's no way that president's going to know that, okay? So know what you know and know what you don't know. And don't try to do what you don't know. Find the people that can tell you how to do it and listen to them. It's hard for a lot of leaders to listen to other people, okay? Anna's probably sitting there thinking, well, I'm not sure she'd call me a leader, but she'd tell you that I don't listen well. But you have to listen to other people, and then you have to have the confidence to act on that. And you might have to have broad enough shoulders that when it doesn't work, you don't go, oh, well, that was George's idea. I mean, if you're the leader, that was a decision you made based on whatever pieces you had in front of you. And if it went wrong, you have to take the responsibility. And you can't blame it on somebody else. So, you know, and then again, I mean, there's the basic things. I've learned the hard way that once you lose trust in somebody, you're not going to get it back. And one of the hardest things in being any kind of leadership position is having to dismiss people. And I'm not very good at that. the mistake you make is allowing people to stay longer than they should stay because you don't want to deal with it. That's different than giving somebody a second or even a third chance when you think they deserve it. But recognizing, you know, when you lose trust in somebody, that's the end of the road, and you need to deal with it. You deal with it quicker than anything else. So those are some of the things that I can think of. That one thing I know is you can put all that down on a piece of paper. Doing it's not so easy. You know.
Let me provide a little comfort for you. Behind your back, Ian does call you a leader. That's why you're here today, by the way. Matt, I'll come to you next.
My name is Martha Cozier, and I oversee social media for the Navy's professional reading program, which is based here at the Naval War College. I'm listening to you, and I just can't get over how appropriate it is that you're here today, because today is the 24th anniversary of President George H.W. Bush sending in 1,800 Marines to Somalia to help the United Nations distribute food and humanitarian assistance to the people there who were being starved during the Civil War. And they couldn't have done it without the United States military. And unfortunately, we were caught up in a civil war with the warring clans and tribes. And the following October, of course, we had the Black Hawk Down incident. But whoever controls the water, the food, and the power grid, the energy grid, really controls the people.
Food is power.
It really is. And I'm really encouraged to hear that it was your foundation that went in and established the hydroelectric plant rather than ExxonMobil or Shell, which traditionally they do. They did that in South America. Do you find that you are partnering with corporate America to do things like that?
We do. Let me first of all say about Somalia, and I'll say this, and I'm totally out of place saying it, but I'm going to say it, is from what I know about it, you better understand your mission. And when you get cross missions, you get in trouble. And that hurt a lot of people that we pulled out of there the way we pulled out of there when things went wrong. And I'm not judging it, because I would have no business judging it. But I'm just saying, you know, 20 years later, you can look at that, and you can look at where Somalia is today. And not maybe we could have, maybe we couldn't have, you know, had a different, seen a different direction. But you got to know your mission, and you've got to stay. I mean, actually, this is another answer to your question in leadership. You must stay focused, and if you don't stay focused, you will not be as effective, and you will waste resources, and you'll lose opportunities. So, you know, a leader has to know how to pull yourself. I mean, all of us get distracted. All of us will wander a little bit, but a leader has to know how to pull that back in, and you've got to pull it back in, and you've got to control it. But I think, you know, when you look at the history of ourselves in those situations, I think, again, it goes to what is your commitment going in, and are you willing to stick it out? And you being in social media, we today, so many things are judged unfairly and so quickly. And it just kills me that you take a guy like General McChrystal, who is so talented and a great leader and is willing to take the risks that he took, and he makes one mistake and he's out. You know, and so those things are killers. You know, those things are killers. A real leader would have, I think, would have tried to figure out, I don't know all the facts, so there could be something I don't know. But, you know, would have been trying to figure out not how to fire the guy, but how to keep him there. And I'm not saying that wasn't done, because I don't know the facts. But what was the last part of your question?
That's
a good question. So we've done several things with a couple of different corporations. I think they're good partners, and they can be good partners. obviously depends on the company. We were just talking on the airplane over here. Ann and I, we're funding a study for 4 or 6 hydroelectric plants.
Six.
Potential new hydroelectric plants. And we both realized, okay, we built this one on the relationship and trust we have in one person. Now, he's got a great business plan, but if he leaves, what's that? Well, that's the thing. However, it's very fragile because let's say he's fired, okay? That business plan can be co-opted pretty fast.
Well, also, how do you protect a hydroelectric plant?
I'll answer that. I'll tell you what. I mean, there are some elements that would worry about. But I will tell you, when we sat down on different occasions with the M23 rebels trying to figure out if we could play some role in that peace process, the very first thing they talked about was the projects we were doing, how appreciative they were, because their people were going to benefit, and they were sincere about that, okay? They might have had other issues, but they did care about that. And the first thing we would get is a list of the other things they thought we should be doing. Now, that list was often self-serving for certain populations. We knew that, but... And we didn't do any of those. We also got, an email once from Emmanuel saying, well, there were, 7 RPG hits at the construction site, but none of them hit any of the equipment. Nobody was injured, so we're okay. But I just buy another bulldozer. They blow a bulldozer up, I'll buy another bulldozer. And I'll buy 3 more if that's what it takes. As long as I think we're going to get it done, they're not going to stop me with that. But what we have to do, if we were to build another one, we'll have to find, actually, most likely, a corporation that we can partner with, because we'll have to have a structure outside of the government that can protect the integrity of that project in a different way. And that's really difficult to do. And it also gets us bumping up against the line of what then qualifies as charitable. Because our money has to be charitable in nature. You can use a broad definition in different places for that. But we can't, if you're talking about a corporation that's a for-profit corporation paying out dividends to shareholders, how can our money help them make money? Now, there may be a structure that you can put in place where you can avoid that conflict, and I'm not convinced there isn't. And we're doing something in Ghana with a very large U.S. company, farm equipment company, that we don't have it done yet, but we're working on a couple ideas that I hope we get done with them that are pretty innovative in the change we want to make. Will some individual farmers benefit? They benefit in the process, but if we can change the way the government looks at things, if we can change how farmers are going to farm and how they're going to preserve their soil, there's a huge public benefit to that. So there's this line that isn't always defined by the Internal Revenue Service as to, a program expense that is purely charitable. And there's room to get in trouble there. There's room for redefinition, and there's room for interpretation. But I'm somebody who will go to a lawyer and say, is there a way we can do this? And if there's a way to do it, we'll try it. But it's a really good question, because in the end, when we do something like that hydroelectric plant, I don't see the risk as somebody, doing damage to it. It's possible.
Like, do you have to hire a paramilitary organization?
No, we don't have anybody. No.
Let me move on now. We've only got time for maybe 2 more questions. I think you had one back there, and then Q over here. Go ahead, Colin.
Sir, Don Merrin from the War Gaming Department here.
War Gaming?
War Gaming.
Wow, that sounds cool. I like that.
The question I have for you is priority. You talk about you invest about $150 million a year, a very broad mission. How do you decide where to spend that $150, which is really a drop in the bucket compared to the need out there?
It might be a drop in the bucket, but it's not so easy to give it away intelligently, I can tell you that. That's Ann's number one job, is to keep me focused on the right priorities. It's hard when you have resources not to respond to things in an ad hoc way. And I've done that all my life. I'll guarantee I'll do it more. But I think one of the things that pulls me back to trying to keep the priorities limited, which is the key, I think, is that I've seen what happens when we go too much like this. And you lose effectiveness, you lose impact, and particularly where we're in the places we're working, you lose it pretty fast if you don't stay focused. As far as selecting the priorities, to be honest with you, it's one of the greatest things about having a private foundation. You get to select your priorities. I mean, you get to think this year what's important, next year what's important. And I do believe that as a foundation, we should do a couple things. And one of those things is take a lot of risk. We should be willing, we should be the risk capital in terms of the money into places where there's great need. And unfortunately, that's hard for a lot of foundations to do for different reasons. But for us, it's quite easy. And so one of my priorities is to make sure that we are, at least for the majority of our money, we're somewhere where most people aren't, and we're somewhere where most people don't want to be. And believe me, you can find those places. That's why we're in Liberia, Sierra Leone, South Sudan, Burundi, Congo. I mean, you know, now we're even going to, we're actually starting this year to zero those priorities down even tighter. So we can try to be more effective in the areas where we work. It's a difficult decision because you realize that as you scale that back and refocus more, you'll have less impact, you know, overall, but hopefully we can have more impact where we are. One thing I learned, a very tough lesson over well over a decade and $200-300 million later, is projects don't work very well. And the truth is our government tends to work on a project basis. So if I go, well, the way I really learned it was when we were doing ag projects. We were doing 7 different ag projects in 7 different countries in Africa. And when I went back towards the end of those projects, I realized we are leaving people in a situation where they're not ready to be left. We are probably creating a situation in some, if not most cases, where when we leave, if you go back 2 years later, they could even be worse off than when we were there. Because they're not, we haven't changed the fundamentals. We haven't changed the policy. We haven't changed the impact of what they live with. So if they live with poor roads and no electricity and a government that doesn't give them what they need, what has our project done? It's made them dependent for 5 years on something that we are interjecting into their life that now we're not going to give them anymore. So when you start giving people things, and there are cases where you have to give people things. I mean, you know, but when you start giving people things, you start to undermine the principles that make things work long term. It's that simple. We're going to pull a past program, a great, I think the best program in Africa where it comes to agriculture that we fund, not our program, but we're going to pull them out of Sierra Leone and Liberia just because we can't continue to function the way we're functioning. Joe sends us a letter and he says, well, they're going to go into Liberia and there's these NGOs that are just going to give thousands of seeds away to thousands of farmers. His goal is to build seed businesses and to make people independent and to help farmers be able to afford to buy seed rather than depend on NGOs. That just wipes him out. He's done, okay? And when these guys quit giving it away, Joe's not there. The entrepreneurs that he wants to find and build into seed dealers aren't there. And guess what? Nobody else is there. It's really damaging. It's really damaging. And you know, when you think about what the choices are, and this example is something I leave you with to think about, because different people will answer it different ways, but it's kind of a combination of all the questions that have been asked, because it goes to a leadership question as well. When I was in South Sudan a long time ago with the SPLA, some of the SPLA, this is in the book too, and I think I call it the 3-beer story or whatever. I don't know, but you get a couple beers in somebody and you get a lot more information. I'm sure that's an old military tactic. You know, I'm talking to this guy who lost a leg in fighting and was a colonel he said, "Well, I'll tell you a story. You Westerners think everything is black and white and easy." He said, "I'll tell you a story. When we were fighting, we came across a situation where some of the militants we were fighting had put mines around a village of about 500 people. And the food agencies were aware of it. Obviously, no one in that village would walk outside to try to collect wood or collect food or anything else. So somebody had to make the decision. Are we going to airdrop food into that village, knowing that those insurgents will take 20 or 25% of that food?" And the insurgents are smart enough to know that if they take 20 or 25%, you might think about dropping it. If they're going to take 50% or 75%, you might not drop it. So they're pretty smart, okay? And which reminds me of another story, which I won't tell you, but we learned about the revolving refugees and IDPs in Somalia and how the warlords were so clever they would move people around to different camps so they could continue to collect. I mean, it's amazing how clever people are. But anyway, so you have to make the decision. Are you going to drop food into that village and you know that a certain portion of that is going to go to the insurgents or militants or whatever you want to call them, and those guys are killing people, okay? Or are you just going to let those people starve to death in that village because they will starve to death? That's a tough decision, but somebody had to make it. And they dropped, this guy said, you know, routinely they would make the decision to drop the food. Now, that's a leadership question. I mean, that, are you willing to make that decision? And that's a question on several different levels, okay? But I guarantee you the person making that decision was willing to lose his or her job because somebody could easily come along and say, "Well, you can't do that shit." You just can't do that. And so I think, you know, when you're in, I mean, this is so classic for a military situation. When you're in it, okay, you don't have a playbook. You don't get to call back and huddle and get everybody's opinion. You have to make a decision. You have to make a call. That's what leadership is about, making the call, being smart enough to put and develop the opportunities around you to be prepared to make that call, and then make it at the risk of your own personal benefit.
Time for that one last question.
Yeah.
Please. Tracy Davis, I'm in the Army. My question was...
A grunt. Isn't that what they call you guys?
Well, you were an infantry guy, that's right.
Okay.
For me, my question is kind of, you already answered part of it, but the one other question I have was, what are your biggest job challenges, like the first, what are the number one, number two maybe job challenges that you have trying to fill the opportunities in your foundation?
Well, one of them is one you don't have here. We live in Decatur, Illinois. Nobody wants to live in Decatur, Illinois, unless you grew up in Decatur, Illinois. Seriously, that is one of our biggest challenges. I think the other challenge we have, which has been discouraging for Ann and for me and Tricia and some of the people who have been around for a while, we have a very unique culture in our foundation. And in some ways it's difficult, but if you find the right person, it can be pretty exciting. And so our challenge is finding people who fit into our culture. And you know, many cultures are different, but and I don't know how to define our culture exactly, except that we are quick to make decisions. We are willing to go, you know, go places other people don't go. Now that some people don't want to do that because of personal risk, okay? Some people don't want to do it because they just don't feel they're able to deal in those kinds of environments. And I think that when you have, this is a big problem. This is a problem for Jimmy Carter. It's a problem, not that I'm a Jimmy Carter, don't get me wrong, but First of all, I'm a Republican. But you know, when Jimmy Carter is no longer around, what is the Carter Center? You know, when Bill Clinton is no longer around, what is CGI? I mean, so you have the Howard G. Buffett Foundation. When Howard G. Buffett's not around anymore, what is that foundation? It goes to a really difficult question in terms of culture, because I'm very opinionated, I'm very driven. I worked for somebody like this, Dwayne Andreas. I mean, this guy was, you know, I mean, I could tell you some stories about that. And you just had to understand, don't take it personally. Tomorrow's another day. The opportunity that comes with it is worth it. So, you know, when you're in a situation like ours, and in a way it equates to the military, because if you got a lieutenant you don't like, but he's your lieutenant, you're living with him. Now that'll change someday, but you got to be able to put up with that for as long as you got to put up with it. And so, you know, I think I'm part of the problem in our culture, but I don't think that's unique. I think if you take any situation where you have, you know, a very driven, opinionated person that's in control, you will run up against that. And I really do think there's a lot of parallel to that in the military. I mean, you have a lot of decision making concentrated in certain ranks, and it's going to come down, and you can easily feel that you have no influence over how to change that. And so I think that's a really big challenge for us at our foundation, but I don't think that's unique to a lot of locations or a lot of places. No, we would hire somebody. Two things happen. They rotate unexpectedly because we change something and we go, hey, you did a pretty good job at this, try that. We took our program officer, Central America, and put her in charge of the biggest single project we've ever funded, $24 million, in South Africa, because we had no one else who had the program experience that we felt comfortable, you know, to do this. Now we tried to give her help with other personnel and other resources, but we threw her into that. And you know, some people would go, wait a minute, I speak Spanish, I go down there where the climate's nice and the, you know, people give me tortillas, I mean, I'm not going to South Africa. I mean, you know, but you know, her reaction was immediately to look at the opportunity to figure out how she could help. And so, you know, that happens with us. And I lost a very good person 4 or 5 years ago who just couldn't deal with that and just sat down and she said, I can't do this. I don't want to lose our friendship, but I can't, you know, I need to be focused on this and this is what I got to do. So we've lost some people over that historically. It's a very challenging thing. So we bring people in that at the time of where we are able to apply a certain set of skills to something that we're focused on. But I will tell you that, and Ann will tell you this, 2 years ago, we started down a track that we had no idea where it was going to lead us. I got a phone call. I was finishing planting soybeans, and I got a phone call from a good friend, and she said, you need to be in Africa tomorrow. And I said, do you know how long it takes to get to Africa? I said, you know, I'm on a tractor in Illinois. And she said, well, you got to be there the next day. And so Ann was moving to Decatur at the time with her about 3-year-old son then or whatever he was, and had her mother there helping her. I called her up and I said, Ann, go to Walmart, get 2 sleeping bags, one for you and one for me. You make sure you have your passport, and I gave her 3 other little things, and I said, because if we don't leave tomorrow, we're leaving the next day for Africa. Where are we going? Well, I don't know exactly where we're going, but we're going to go, and we'll get that information in the next 24 hours. And that's when we went over to South Sudan at a undisclosed temporary base and interviewed General Caesar Chelim. From that point on, We did so many things I never dreamed we would do, and some things I wasn't sure we could do until I asked enough lawyers. And so our whole life has been different the last couple of years than anything close to what it was before that. So in our foundation, you know, you have to adjust to that. You have to be willing to, not be so stuck on a particular geography or a particular project or a particular whatever. You have to. I know I'm like keep looking this way. That's because I'm like, but that's because we want to be unpredictable. We don't want to be predictable. If we're predictable, we're not doing our job right. I mean, one of the biggest things that we preach and what this book is all about is you want to be out of business in 40 years. Whatever you start, you want to be done in 40 years and you want to be out of business. Think if every NGO around the world had to be out of business in 40 years. Might be better if they were out of business in 20 years. But you had to start over, okay? It's like a zero-sum, basis for your finances. I mean, you start over. And when you start over, it means you can look at it freshly. It means you can do things differently. It means you aren't held to the same, ideas that you had before. And I think that's probably one of the most important things you can have in a military is, think if you were given the opportunity, all right, you can go into Somalia. You can build a plan. You can assist with these guys, and you have 40 years to do it. And I'm going to give you 40 years to do it, but you're done in 40 years. We've never done anything like that. And it takes a different mindset, and it takes a different risk. Now, granted, you have different presidents and stuff like that, so things change. The State Department guys would know well. But we have to start deciding if we want to think differently. And it's going to take us thinking differently, I believe, to deal with the issues that we're facing in front of us. I think Chuck Hagel was right when he said, and it probably got him fired, but when he said that we have never faced anything like ISIS, we have to admit we have never faced anything like this. That means we have to change our tactics. That means we have to change our thinking, change our strategies. It might change what our leadership capabilities look like in the men and women that are going to tackle it. So, I think too often we don't want to admit that we're wrong. We don't want to admit that there's a problem out there that we don't know how to solve. And we don't want to take the chance of the risk to go out and try to solve it at a personal stake. And we have to change that thinking.
I know there are a lot of other questions that would like to be asked. We've heard responses to those questions that were raised. We've heard about things like trust, the importance of relationships, of knowing and shaping your culture. We heard about the importance still of using intuitive decision making, that gut decision making. But I was also pleased to hear a recognition of the importance of having the critical thinking background represented by people like Ann and Matrasa, who are doing that, using the criteria to help guide the final intuitive.
Oh, I need a lot of guidance, believe me.
We do appreciate very much your coming all the way to Newport specifically to speak to you folks. Thank you.
You
from
bet.
The Naval War College.
Thank you.